By a trans person before?
I feel like the answer has to be yes, but I can't remember it.
It probably is. People don't realize that trans people are everywhere.
Yeah, that's true.
Most people have probably most people do know a trans person. And they just don't know it.
Yeah, I think that's true. It's like its success is its failure. Because the more successful the trans people are, the more no one even knows that they are trans.
That is the norm. Well, I'm trying to get them not to be so closed about it. You know,
yeah.
I'm hoping to be more open, but anyway. But I have to ask, because the five questions.
Okay,
Julia
five
Sweeney.
Questions.
Okay.
Okay.
So I have to ask about Pat, because it's like, I'm a big fan of Pat. I always was. But where did the character of Pat come from?
It was not from a trans, beginning. It was really, definitely a guy. Although later, let me just tell you the beginning. The very beginning was, there was a person I worked with who was a guy, definitely a guy, not trying to not be a guy, clearly a guy, who was so annoying in such a specific way that I could not help purging myself of the annoyance of being around him by imitating him to my friends. Okay, so that's how it started. So I started doing that. And he had certain qualities, like he drooled a lot, and he had a lot of allergies and nose running. So there was just stuff coming out of his face all the time. And he also stood way too close. So he would say, "Hey, how are you doing?" Like it was an inappropriate close talker. And I worked with him. And it just was funny. So I just started doing him. Like, I would just do, like, it was all this part of Pat. Okay. Then, that was that. Then later, I was an accountant then. I worked with a woman who also, not specifically, but she had this really interesting kind of androgyny to me. Because at the time, like, David Bowie or Michael Jackson or even Katie Lang, there was this whole androgynous thing happening, and I thought, the real androgyny is the middle-aged woman who's just too tired to take care of herself. I mean, that is, like, everyone's acting like androgyny is this crossing the barrier of gender. But what about where you're past gender? Where you don't even care about your hair. You don't care about makeup. You're too tired to care about your clothes. So I knew she was a woman, and she was just a haggard mom who didn't have any time. But I just always thought that was funny, because I felt like popular culture was talking a lot about this one type of androgyny, and yet this other type of androgyny was so ubiquitous. Then there was another guy, a different guy, who I worked with, who used to ask me to lunch and not take no for an answer. And it wasn't a date kind of thing, he was married, but it was just an oblivious thing. So he'd say, "You want to have lunch?" And I would say, "I'm sorry, I can't." He'd go, "Well, then what about tomorrow?" And I'd say, "I can't tomorrow. What about the next day?" And it was like, there was no way to get away from this person. So all those people sort of ended up being combined into Pat. And I just did it at the Groundlings. And actually, I was kind of trying to be a guy, but I wasn't a good enough actress. And then I thought, well, I'll just throw in a joke where you don't know if it's a man or a woman to kind of really cover for my lack of acting ability. But then that became the audience-pleasing part of it. And then once the audience started laughing at that, it was just impossible not to think of joke after joke. So that's how that's the long answer.
Wow.
That's the long answer.
Good answer. Actually, that leads to question number two.
Oh, right.
How did you get your start as a performer?
Well, I always told funny stories, but I grew up with a lawyer father and a mother who didn't teach but had a teaching degree, and all her sisters were teachers, and all my aunts were teachers. And it seemed to me that the world, if you were a man, you became a lawyer, and if you were a woman, you became a teacher. And for some reason, I didn't ever think of anything beyond that. My big thing was like, I'll be a lawyer. So that was going to be my big breaking out of the mold. Okay. So, because I was so liberated. And I went to college thinking I might be a lawyer, and then I really loved movies, and I fell in with a group of people who loved movies. I took a lot of film classes in college. And I still didn't think of being a performer. And then I went to LA and became an accountant. And there was something in me, because I always had been funny, that just, I didn't even really know about stand-up. I just felt like that was that was part of me that needed to get out. And so I started taking, I read a review of the Groundlings Theater in Los Angeles while I was an accountant. And I started taking classes, and as soon as I started taking classes, my whole life changed. It was like, oh, here's all these people. They're all trying to be actors. I'm in LA. I love film, but I never thought of being an actor. But I do want to be an actor. And in some ways, I used to liken it to people telling me about how, of them coming out of the closet. Like, it was something I think I had always known about myself, but hadn't really explored. And it wasn't like I was keeping it down. It was just, I didn't know how to express it yet. Like, I didn't have an idea of how do you become an actor? And once I saw people who were making a living as an actor and in comedy, it was like within a month my entire life changed, and I quit accounting and I threw myself into comedy and I tried to learn everything you could about it. So that was the beginning.
Wow. I'm pretty tall. Okay, in the entertainment biz, whether you're a musician or an actor or comedian, there seems to be a big mythology about about making it big, about having, you know, some kind of a break to have stardom. Yeah. So, is there really such a thing as a big break?
Well, I would say for me, yes. And I'm so oblivious. I have this quality about me that I've only now in my 50s come to realize of oblivious in really key areas that has served me well and has hurt me. Okay, so in the way that has hurt me is I didn't understand how much getting on Saturday Night Live was such a big break. I was really kind of like, oh yeah, and then Saturday Night Live. Like, it wasn't like I wasn't excited. I was excited. I understood it was a big deal. But as I get older, I realize how big a deal. And so that really was a big break. On the other hand, I often think, and I'm so thankful that I got to be on Saturday Night Live, but there are times where I think, what would my life have been if I hadn't? Because I don't know if my skills are exactly suited for Saturday Night Live, frankly. Like, I might have been better off on a sitcom, or I might have explored more dramatic acting if I hadn't gone on Saturday Night Live. Or maybe I would have written more. Like, so, I don't know. Like, it was a big break, but who knows what would have happened if I hadn't gotten on. Maybe nothing, and I would be back to being an accountant. But maybe something different that was even more exciting. It's impossible to know.
But you did get a big break.
I got a big break, yeah.
You did. You did.
It was a big break. No, I did. Yes.
Okay. Okay. This is a tough one. Number four.
Oh.
How do you define success in the entertainment business?
Apply
to anything.
First of all, I don't know exactly. I think I could take up the next 10 hours if you want to see answering this question, and I would end up with no answer. I don't know how to answer that, but I will tell you what I'm thinking about right now.
Okay, go ahead.
Because I'm trying to do this new thing where every year on January 1st, or around that time, I write something, if I die this year. Okay, now that sounds morbid, but actually I think it's really positive. Where I try to frame my efforts, my artistic efforts, in a realistic, not cheerleading fake way, but in a realistic, acceptable, beautiful way. Where I say, yes, this is what I did. If I die in 2014, the best thing I did was letting go of God, to me, in my opinion. But I also created other monologues and a book that I'm proud of that is a memoir. And I think I did good work. I think I was good on Saturday Night Live, but I mostly had fun on Saturday Night Live. I wouldn't, you know, like that, I don't know if that's success. I mean, it was fame, you know, but that isn't necessarily success. I would say for me, success is working really hard on something that's just beyond my ability to do. And then kind of attaining it. That's really success to me.
That is a very good answer.
and letting go of God for me was that it was a little beyond my ability to do, and I think I pretty much nailed it. I wouldn't say 100%, but it was the hardest I worked on something that was just beyond my reach. And that makes me feel like I succeeded. Like, it's okay if I die because I did that.
Oh God!
I know. But, first of all, I'm totally not planning to die.
Totally.
I have so much to do until I'm like 100. I have so many things, but I think it's a good, like, almost zen place to make it okay. Because, like, if you are suddenly find yourself with the train rushing towards you and you're absolutely gonna die, I don't want to be upset. I want to feel like, okay, train, I did what I could. But you know
that Jill's going to be on that train, living in the caboose. We had this conversation about where we're going to live, and Jill's going to live on a train. So that's the train that's going to run over Julie Sweeney and end this tremendous ride.
Jill!
Everything she's done. The hardest question of all.
Oh.
What is next for Julia Sweeney?
Part of me doesn't want to say, because my dream is so ambitious and yet so common and so often foiled that it can't possibly be a good thing for me to announce it.
Okay.
but I will say that I don't want to perform anymore. I shouldn't say anymore. It feels like anymore, but I don't never say never. You know, I'm doing these shows with Jill. But I really want to be quiet and write. I really want to write, and I might want to direct, and I have an idea that I'm going to try to realize over the next 3 years.
Sounds exciting. We'll have to wait for that one.
Yes.
Yeah, so thank you, Julia.
And Fran.
Thank you.
Fran's the best.
He's so happy. Me want to cry.
Oh.